disaster, starting from the big picture level and looking across this region and experiencing that and then going from there.
Okay. Station has put me in this box by design in her hope to get me to shut up. So I'm going to shut out of there.
I would never put you in this box.
And Station, thank you very much. This is really a very intimidating crowd. Boy, I can't get away with anything here. I'm looking over there, all this. The truth tellers over there. Well, anyway, Boca Raton. Everybody knows Boca Raton. Certainly everybody in this room. And we all remember the Chibok girls and Michelle Obama, Bring Back Our Girls, and all that stuff. But I'd like to, if it's okay, do what Stacey told me to do. Flesh that out a little bit and sort of set the stage for wiser souls than myself to build on. A few things. 2014, Boko Haram was the number one killing machine in the world, having killed between 6,600 and 6,700 people, and in control of an area the size of Bella. And in 2015, Nigeria and its neighbors pushed them out of the city with help from some South Africans and others, showing amazing regional cooperation, pushed Boko out of the cities, out of the towns, and many of the villages. In the same year, Nigeria and its neighbors did something I never thought they could do. I shouldn't say that. I retract that. Of course they did this. They formed the MNJTF, and they actually cooperate. And they go across borders readily. What a difference that has made. But despite all of that impressive progress, the terrorists continue to strike with impunity across northeastern Nigeria and the border areas of Niger, Chad, and Cameroon. And as a result, today, as we sit in this hot room, which brings to mind Nigeria, actually, there are 2.5 million displaced persons, and the number is rising in the Lake Chad region. There are 10.7 million people dependent upon humanitarian assistance, and the number is rising. So many things to say, but the station's giving me ugly looks already. August 2016, Boko split, and the larger, more threatening faction, ISIS West Africa, under a guy called Al-Barnawi, and of course the other faction, we continue to call Boko Haram under Shekau. So what has been America's response to all of this? Well, it's pretty amazing, I say so myself. First of all, is it unique? I don't think so. But very rare in America to actually have a coordinated U.S. government. And we sort of do. I don't want to overstate it, but more or less, the three Ds, diplomacy, development, defense, coming together. As senior coordinator of Boko Haram, a job I've had since February of 2015, sort of my job to sort of do that. And every week, our key mechanism for this is our weekly civets, which this week just ended a couple hours ago. And everybody and his dog and his mother-in-law are in this civet. U.S. government only, Europe, Pentagon, intelligence agencies, all five posts, and many, many others, and certainly the whole Washington interagency. Everybody's in there. It's a very aggressive civet. It's not a let's look and see it. The week that was, it's all forward-looking, driven by an agreed agenda, followed by comprehensive notes. So this coordination effort is more than just the weekly sit. It's also a P3 coordination effort, and it's also a reaching out to experts. I've already nailed Sharif. Poor Sharif had never seen me before in his life, and he's already lined up to speak to a round table. Yeah, Jez is looking the other way. He wasn't even made. So coordination effort has worked. Now, why is that? When I told my wife in February 2015, she's not too excited about any of this, I'll be frank. I said, and she just laughed. She said, "You're going to do what?" And I said, "I'm going to coordinate America's response to help our partners." And she said, "That is mission impossible." She and I both come from farms. And she said, "That's like herding 100 farm cats." Ain't going to happen. You know something? She was wrong. First time ever in our 47 years. Tell her I said that. Because in fact, there is general agreement within the U.S. government on America's policy to support our Lake Chad region partners in this fight. What is the basis of that agreement? I'm going to list them off. Put four things. One, Nigeria matters. Within my lifetime, if I lived to be as old as great uncle Alfred, he was 104. So that means I'm alive at 2050, Nigeria will be the third most populous country in the world. Nigeria already is the number one, number two economy. It's our number two trading partner, huge diaspora in America. Opportunities for investment and trade, enormous. Nigeria matters, its neighbors matters, this fight matters. That's agreement number one. Agreement number two, this is not America's war. When this new administration came in, I waited 2 weeks, ran over to the White House and said, "Hey, here I am, what do you guys think?" And they said to me, "America does not need any more wars." And they're right, this is not America's war. And our support is by, with, and through our partners, both on the security side and on the civilian side. Three, our partners cannot bomb their way to victory. And I was just out at Abuja just a couple days ago, meeting with all of the military intelligence chiefs from all four countries, and the one thing they all agreed on, they didn't say this 3.5 years ago, they said it last week, there is no military-only solution to this. And that you have to address the drivers of the conflict. I am really insistent on this. I'm of the Vietnam War era. I'm probably the only person in the room who even remembers it. We killed every Viet Cong 10 times over. And we lost the war because we couldn't understand the war. Not going to happen on my watch. And it's not terrible. The fourth area of fundamental agreement is that the ISIS, the connection to global jihadism, ups the ante. So those are four areas of general agreement. Out of all of this comes an agreed strategy. We actually have a strategy, one that makes sense. We had a 32-page one that I'm the only human being that actually read. Now I understood why nobody else read it. It made no sense. Now we have a 7-page one that is on my desktop as a reference. Out of this, we have a robust engagement on the security side, advisor, intel collection capacity, intelligence sharing, training troops, fuel for Niger and Chad, equipment, selling super Tucanos in Nigeria, so much to talk about. But a lot has gone on in supporting on the security side. We and our P3 partners and others, we continue this security engagement as we're sitting right here, and it has had an impact, and the terrorists do feel the pain of that pressure. Nonetheless, I would say the best characterization to give the prevailing situation on the ground would be a stalemate. I call it a whack-a-mole. I come from a farm background. County fair, you play whack-a-mole. Do people know what that is?
Yeah.
Okay. That's sort of what it's like. Our partners to this day lack the capacity to hold territory, to restore civilian security, to establish effective governance, to deliver service, to kickstart economies that are dead. That's not happening. And so the whack-a-mole goes on and on. But, you know, there's more than one way to skin a cat. And so we've shifted our focus, and you're going to hear about it so much, especially Elizabeth, who knows everything on this, to promoting defection through active and harmonized 4DR programs. So that's one big approach. And to promote stabilization in those areas. Because if you go in Adamawa, if you go in Yobe states, there are places that are adequately, sufficiently secure where you can start to put pieces back together. And so we're working on some of those. So anyway, Elizabeth will have all the details about the 4DR, so I'm not going to talk about that. In terms of helping on the stability side, the stabilization side, we are now helping Nigeria rebuild police stations, rebuild police barracks. We're training prosecutors and judges and prison officials. We're right now seeking agreement with the Nigerians to establish training for specialized police to fill in behind the military. So we're ready, as security permits, we're ready to help rebuild health facilities, education, economic revival, especially through agriculture and innovation, so many areas. So I think that sets the stage for discussion about 4DR, about stabilization. So I think I'm going to leave it at that. You're not making too ugly of a face at me, so I'm still alive. And I ask you not to pay any attention to me, because you'll see me feverishly taking notes, because I'm stealing every idea I can get away with. Thank you very much.
Cipher between kidnapped victims of Boko Haram returning from captivity ISWAR designated foreign terrorist organizations, and all are subject to 3 levels of sanctions. Material support statute, U.S. sanctions, Treasury OFAC, and United Nations sanctions. Here's the deal. The U.S. laws cannot keep up with the pace of what's going on around. So because the war in the Northeast is so convoluted, with Boko Haram, mass kidnapping of schoolgirls, we've all seen it in the news, pillaging of villages, using 9-year-old girls, suicide bombers in crowded markets, it's made it really difficult for our lawyers to allow blanket assistance, to say, here's a blanket assistance memo to provide help for minors, for example. So we're left with a situation right now that we rely on legal analysis, case by case by case, using the vetting systems of the Nigerian military and government to provide direct assistance to any victims of the war. Basically, even a bottle of water to the Chibok girls would have to be vetted, and you have to know who that person is, and be sure that someone has confirmed that they're no longer an affiliate of Boko Haram or ISIS West Africa. That's how basic we're talking about. Even trying to do analysis and research in the region on this Boko ISWA problem set has proved complicated. If we're conducting key informant interviews or household interviews on the ground and we want firsthand knowledge, we have to be really careful that we're not inadvertently providing material support to individuals without some sort of vetting system in place, knowing who they are. Let's face it, most of the time, this is going on in the middle of nowhere, in a war zone. It's not very realistic. I think we're always going to know exactly who these people are you're offering a bottle of water to have in focus group. But we actually most of the time say we feel like we're spending more time fighting bureaucracy than we are violent extremist organizations. The key to our ability to provide any direct support to civilian populations that are swept up in this war is knowing who they are. To avoid providing assistance to DTOs and thus violating the laws, in Nigeria we rely, as I said, on the official process of the Nigerian military. So this has been done by the Nigerian program owned by the Nigerians called Operation Safe Border. It's a civil entity that was set up in 2016 and we have supported to integrate so-called repentant combatants. They screen folks in 3 categories. Number 1 are victims or former affiliates considered super low risk, and they bring them in and then they release them into a rehabilitation center that we've been supporting. The 2nd are people who are considered low risk ex-combatants. So they were fighters, but they're considered low risk by the military. And they're put into a de-radicalization camp called GOPEC. The 3rd category are people who are active combatants. They're categorized as such high risk, and they're sent to high security prisons for prosecution. So that's really important, those distinctions, because that's the only way we know who we're dealing with. Our lawyers are very comfortable, USA lawyers very comfortable in using that classification in order to really start somewhere and know how to work with these people. We work with our lawyers to understand and acknowledge this vetting would be enough to provide support if we could. And finally, in 2017, we saw what can happen when you have some planning, advanced planning, and knowing how to at least be as prepared as possible. In 2017, we were asked to provide emergency assistance the day before the arrival of 566 women and children that were released from Biwa prison. Some kids were born in Biwa prison, they've been there a long time. And they were sent to the rehabilitation center. So working closely with our lawyers, we adapted a system where we could provide support to them, and early assistance was basically like food, hygiene, diapers, toys, we did a toy center, very basic stuff. But it was the first time that we were really able to move quickly and have our lawyers backing us and saying, yes, we can do this, and we know who they are. Until recently, USAID OTI, and since we've done a lot more support to people who continue to come out and go into that women's rehab center. Until recently, OTI has only provided assistance to victims deemed releasable to that center, but recently we had a really, really significant step in the policy frame. We are authorized to provide direct assistance to individuals in that 2nd category of low-risk former combatants. 95 repentant ex-combatants have successfully graduated from the de-radicalization program at GOME, which has included health services, religious counseling, and vocational training. The idea is that once these ex-combatants are integrated into their communities, they have a way out, and others see that they were able to do that, and they have a way out. The whole bottom line here is an off-ramp. How do they get out of Boko Haram and ISIS what they want out? So it was a significant step forward for us from a policy perspective to be able to work with former combatants. And it's the first time to our knowledge that USAID has provided this level of support to former combatants and could be a model for DDR globally. Okay, I'll wrap it up. So what's next? Given U.S. terrorist financing laws, a formal legal framework for DDR has to happen to allow allow the USGA to work with individuals deemed to be qualifiers and low-risk affiliates of FOCO across West Africa. On December 5th, the government of Nigeria adopted a formal strategy and action plan for DVR. And actually, we had a nice shout-out to Rose Garden when President Buhari was here, and he mentioned he appreciated the U.S. government's support for Operation Safe Corridor. And that was really the one was referring to this action plan for DVR. It will become a government of Nigeria policy eventually. As we continue to work with the government to eventually sign this into law, we're hoping Nigeria serves as a model for other Lake Chad basin countries. The EU and the UK have also expressed interest in committing up to $5 million in additional funding to this effort. A DVR law on the books also commits the government to ensuring due process for the many, many thousands of men, women, and children who have been detained in prisons indefinitely without trial and thus left vulnerable while extremism influences they fester within the walls of legal waiting to be free. So it offers the possibility of an off-ramp if there's one out. So we're going to keep doing what we're doing. We're going to keep coordinating with the international community. We're working together in the interagency. We're having these weekly civics that Ambassador was referring to. We're staying as coordinated as we can on a very fluid situation. But I think number one for us is understanding where we can support and how we do it. And the starting step for us is really having a committed host government, which we have seen the government of Nigeria up to now is very supportive of this. We continue to work every day on the ground in close coordination with foreign state officials, international community partners, and the Nigerian military to continue this momentum that's been established and hopefully be able to pave the way for reconciliation and reintegration into society for many, many people who've lost everything. Thanks, and I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Good afternoon, everybody. How's it going?
Good.
Tough acts to follow on both of those. My name is Sharif Khatib. I was formerly the chief of party. I like to call myself the artist formerly known as the chief of party. So, as Elizabeth has presented, a little bit like my CV, in revisionism seems to make sense. But when you're in the heat of the moment in between jobs, perhaps it doesn't quite. So I'd like to give you a few reflections of what it felt like in the middle of that implementation cycle. A few quick things about our program. The four-year program started in September 2014, so cast your mind back to the situation which Ambassador Mazena just described. It was a different situation in 2014. Boko Haram had immense control over the north of the country. The program started up with a clear intention to do something, but following OTI's ACT, Assess, and Adapt model, we didn't quite know what that was until we had tried a few actions. So that's what we did. The first phase of the projects focused on agriculture and radio initiatives, believing that there was an economic incentive to get life back to normal. There was a community that could be created, if not in the physical space, given the ongoing insurgency, but at least in the radio space. The radio efforts focused on the Dinari community. Second phase of the project, undergoing a very stark strategy change in a very short space of time, and partly in direction from the USAID mission director at the time, Mike Harvey, focused on the return of civic administration and civic infrastructure. So we embarked on a very large effort to return both the individuals and the institutions and their buildings back to the places that had been decimated by Boko Haram. So this is incentivizing local government administrators, judges, police, back into the areas where they should have been serving. And in most cases, district governors LGA chairmen and state governors were very supportive of this effort. The third and final phase of the project was a bit of a panic. We saw that after that immense effort, much like any country in the world where you try to invest so many millions and hope that people think their government is doing better, we actually didn't see that much of a result. I don't think it happens anywhere in the world. So with 1 year left and with finite resources, we decided to take another stark change to our strategy. So we believed that we could much more specifically focus, with all of the knowledge and credibility that we've gained up to now, on the individuals that we believed to be sympathizing, supporting, or affected by insurgent overturns. And based on that, we ended up with a two-pronged strategy for our final year of the project, which was to provide individuals alternatives to extremist action, In all, we did about 450 activities over the four-year period, each average value of about $50,000 to $60,000. That's about $26 million. So it's not a huge program by any objective measure. It's sizable, but it's not huge. The wonderful part of that story is that we've been highly effective. We've been accepted, and we have access to communities which most organizations say are inaccessible. Governors give us the time of day. They will invite us into meetings. Military commanders will do the same thing in the Nigerian military, which is practically unheard of unless you're wearing a uniform. Also very much the case that our formal evaluations of our program are showing very positive results for that last shove of the effort. Elizabeth put forward a very good explanation of the policy end of working in that grey space, and I'd like to spend just a couple of minutes speaking about that. There's actually another instance. There's two instances when I really wish we had the SAR in place a year or two ago, and also the recommendations that the SAR is putting forward. First was acknowledging that this is an insurgency, and that there are agents within communities, part of communities, who are supporting the movement, and also acknowledging that there's an economic argument to be part of the movement if you're a poor Nigerian resident. We really wanted to figure out what were the smuggling and trade routes going across the border and across the Lake Chad Basin. I don't have a security clearance. I have 140 Nigerians on my staff. None of them will have a security clearance. I'm pretty sure an agency in the US government knew those routes, but they weren't willing to share it with us. So as a result, we had to do the entire study ourselves. We did it, we got the results, but it just felt like a slightly controlling 6 months of effort if we knew the answer was there somewhere. The second point is the grey space that Elizabeth spent a lot of time speaking about in necessary detail. So we saw in this movement where, and I'll be blatantly honest, the Nigerian military and the Nigerian government is sometimes regarded as at best complacent and many times complicit in the insurgent movement. So working with this population of the Northeast, which totals about 20 million people, we had to acknowledge that there was a public relations exercise that we had to pull off. And one of them was providing a safe and viable exit route to anyone who might have been caught up in the movement. As Elizabeth had mentioned, the material support clauses are wide-ranging, so that's not just designated terrorist organization members, those are also affiliates, so those are the indentured servants, the forced wives, and the children who are born in captivity, but also armed militia groups, which takes into account the CJTF, the Civilian Joint Task Force, which is largely credited for resisting Boko Haram from taking over the entire Northeast. Two key audiences that we had to work with but were legally prevented from doing so. So what did we do? We muddled along. We fluffed things up a little. We fluffed things as best as we could in the interim, but we worked very closely with our OTI colleagues. So the situation that Elizabeth was describing, and I hope you don't think I'm giving us too much credit, Elizabeth. The primary information with which OTI was able to provide advice to both USAID's General Counsel and also the NSA's General Counsel came from my team of 140 Nigerians who were willing to work in communities and be there every single day. That was a very effective working relationship. We essentially were able to give them the confidence to make the statements that they were making. And the result of this is that we have a very effective program, and it is the first instance both where USAID funding is able to utilize, I believe it's the 7034D authority, to provide direct support to a foreign military to support a DDR program, but also the case that Elizabeth described, where we are able to directly support people who previously would have been considered a DTO affiliate and would have fallen under the material support clause. I think that's all I'm staring at. Is that okay? Great. Okay. Thank you very much.
Gents, I'm going to try and bring it back full circle and pick up from some of the points that the time Ambassador Nazim made and Elizabeth Shuri. Firstly, let's start with a sort of brief reminder of the scale and complexity of the current challenge that Ambassador Nazim mentioned, but it really is significant. So it's the combined effect of conflict, climate change, environmental degradation, poverty, and underinvestment. which is bringing about this deepening insecurity, rapid population growth, and severe vulnerability. The region faces a serious complex emergency affecting 17 million people, and as an ambassador mentioned, 2.3 million displaced and over 10 million in need of humanitarian assistance. So let me just go into that population growth piece for a moment. Nigeria, Niger, and Cameroon populations are projected to double within the next 30 years, and Niger in the next 20. Now, that means we're looking at an extra 250 million people in the region in the next 30 years. And if we add Mali and Burkina Faso into the mix, then we're talking about over 300 million new faces in the region. So if we were looking at the building the capacity to peacefully manage future conflicts, then we're looking at over 600 million as our target audience for those governments. Adding into the complexity is that this is a major migration illicit trade corridor. It's existed for centuries, and no doubt will continue to do so, no matter what steps we take to try and disrupt that corridor. They'll find ways of operating, always have. Just to give you an idea of what we're talking about there, Niger alone is a country of origin and transit for over 300,000 migrants a year. And only about 30% of those are classified by UNHCR as those seeking asylum or fleeing conflict. All right, so it's a pretty grim future outlook. So what do we need to do? I think our collective opinion as the implementers would be that future stabilization efforts need to be complemented by a firm commitment, a measurable commitment by those member states to implementing longer-term development plans in the areas of health, education, employment, governance, and regional security cooperation. Now, in terms of what's going on, I just want to compliment what's already mentioned in terms of OTI's work and creative. And I'm sorry if I'm stepping back into health creative shoes for a moment. Whilst OTI is working from that bottom-up community engagement level, and I think it's worthy of mention what the USAID West Africa is also doing in terms of that top-down effort. Looking at the regional, national, and sub-national level institution engagement in increasing awareness and understanding of the threat and approaches to dealing with it. I think that is unique, though, as far as I'm aware, in terms of looking at these problem sets around the world. So we're doing this thing concurrently with good coordination and information exchange between OTI and the regional mission. So quickly then, some learning points that I think these are practical learning points for future endeavours. Different governments of this region have different views and approaches to managing conflict and violent extremism. There's been a historic lean towards security and counter-terrorism operations, but in some instances that's been heavy-handed and has actually, one would argue, fueled the push factors that support new group recruitment. Now, this also presents a challenge for government-to-government coordination. It may require non-traditional lines of communication, for example, between a Ministry of Interior in one country and a Ministry of Security in another, or even in the case of Mauritania, if you're looking at the broader Sahel, with the Ministry of Islamic Affairs. So it's a really complex web of communication channels that are unique to this situation and problem set. And then the other thing is, one thing to have a strategy and implementation plan, and quite another to actually implement it. It's going to take time and effort for the leaders at all levels to see the benefit of blended approaches, security and development approaches, to be effective. Now, as I understand right now, Chad and Niger are still the only countries in the region that have formal national CBD strategies. Burkina Faso is showing them, and Niger is showing them. Just giving you an idea of the difference of where we're at in terms of progress in this challenge. Again, strategy is one thing, ability and will to implement is another. to staffing, and I guess this would apply to government, but I want to focus on, given the time, on us as implementers of US government programs. These different countries present very different staffing and capacity challenges for example, in Cameroon, where there's been very little history of international development assistance. It's really humanitarian aid that the potential candidates have got experience of. So we've got a massive learning curve in terms of staffing up our programs to actually implement our approaches. Contracting mechanisms. So Stephen and Catherine mentioned the ability to for OTI to procure. Well, I take it back because look at the bigger picture, perhaps Stephen. What OTI has is a contract vehicle to actually get implementing partners out there far. There is another one with USA in terms of the PCIQC, but it really is, I think that's what distinguishes things, that a shortlisted group of organizations are able to be mobilized in fairly rapid order by OTI should a crisis land on us in quick order. The other thing that is definitely a lesson learned and one of the true values of the OTI approach and model is the unique nature of the relationship between OTI and its implementing partners. That one-team approach underpins everything we do, and along with it, the activity cycle, how we select the activities, is fundamental to the success of the programs. And then, another lesson is that this strategy with an OTI program is evolving, as Sharif has mentioned, multiple times in the life of the program. So we don't enter into these initiatives with preconceived ideas about what will work. We go in with some basic assumptions based on information available. And unlike some USA programs, we act first, assess whether we got those assumptions right, and then adapt as we move along, as opposed to protracted assessment phases, which may or may not be valid in the future. Let me also just mention quickly then, absorptive capacities and capabilities of grantees. Stephen mentioned that small is good. We could look at things and say, we should get in there and just fix the problem in rapid order and, hand things back to the government in a better state, but that's clearly not the way to do business, and I think we're all in agreement that's history now. But we have to have a reality check that we're entering into parts of the conflict affected areas are often in areas with poor infrastructure, poor local capacities and capabilities to actually implement. And so the level of the scale of our implementation needs to be gauged accordingly. I just want to mention that we also have to be conscious of other sources of funding, EU, UN, and bilateral support, and even private sector in some instances, and making sure that we're not duplicating efforts.
Great. So what we wanted to do here was really kind of take the SAR and see how either the challenges one still faces in trying to make the SAR happen, or how it actually has been practiced already, or some of its principles have already been practiced, like as an ambassador was saying. There's a cohesive strategy that with everybody who is on board with it, that everyone understands across all the actors, which sounds like a standard, but it's actually very difficult to achieve. And we've seen the fruits of that as well, and Elizabeth really laying out the challenges of the material support provision. What does that mean on the ground in terms of implementation? All of us inside the government and outside are really grappling with this challenge of how to work in these environments with these laws in place. And then Sharif really talking about what happened on the ground then when you're trying to make this happen, and giving some really specific examples of how the SAR could help to benefit, for example, in regards to information sharing. And then just reinforcing that as well, including some examples of just how hard, we know it's hard to be able to implement, but as we're doing these grand strategic plans,
keeping in mind that piece of how do we actually make it happen then on the ground, and what does that mean for the timeframes of what we're trying to achieve, or the things that we need to change, the policies, and groundwork. So in the interest of time, make sure we get some questions in and some discussion. I want to start by taking three questions for our panelists. Are there any questions out there? Oh no, did we put you to sleep?
Matt Osmer from OMB. With the recent reported rise in doorbell violence, I'm curious how that will complicate efforts that are coming in place in the future.
Thank you. Other questions? Yes.
Hi, Caitlin Gallander, Management Systems International. Just in thinking of the community discussion from right before lunch and this evidence-based and push for M&E, and thinking about what Sharif and Elizabeth were talking about in terms of shifting strategies as the context changes, I'm left wondering, how do we tell our story in a way that those shifts in strategy are seen as being really strategic instead of schizophrenic?
Other questions? Yes?
My question actually kind of relates to both these questions. I looked at this region through a pastoralism lens, and so it actually leads very much in with not just West Africa, but East Africa, but it makes me wonder why the U.S. strategy for the Chad Basin seems so separate from the strategy towards the Sahel. You mentioned Mali working with us a little bit on this final points, but what if any is the link between the U.S. strategy in those two regions and the counterterrorism operations more broadly?
I did see a hand up there, so take one.
Susan Maryland, formerly with the Mitchell Group. I did anti-CV assessments in West Africa. Wondered if any of your current activities are dealt with some of the governance issues in the Nigerian government, oppression, corruption, especially in Borneo State.
And we'll want to start. I can start.
Go for it. First of all, it's an excellent question. You asked about this seeming disconnect between the U.S. counter Boko Haram, counter ISIS West Africa strategy and the Sahel. In fact, they were on two separate tracks. And one strategy was completely finalized and endorsed by the current U.S. administration. The other strategy was far along the process. However, we are now coming to the final stages of an effort to create, addressing what you recognize as an issue, a West Africa counterterrorism strategy, which in fact, for the first time, will pull together the Lake Chad region and the Sahel. It's a very good idea. There was nothing wrong with the counter Boko Haram strategy. I think I mentioned it was a real effective guide. I think it will make more sense, however, to have the broader strategy that forces us to prioritize and make hard decisions about where to put resources. That effort should be finished, I'm going to say, within a couple months.
I can jump in on the evidence-based community. Thank you for that question. Strategic versus schizophrenic. I think I love the way you phrase that. I think for us, it's always going to be based on what's really happening on the ground. So those shifting conditions on the ground, we, part of our business model, every 6 months or so, we have a stop pause. And we take a hard look at what is going on inside the communities at the level, at literally the granular level. Working with our military colleagues to understand kinetics in the region, shifts and changes on the ground. And while the overall arching objective of the program will not change, the actual way we're implementing, as Sharif was talking about, will shift. So we will pivot if we need to. And if we decide that redeployment of public administration and bringing back community centers and police stations isn't necessarily helping people to turn away from Boko Haram, we might start going for influencers and charging at Damasak to Maiduguri Deeper Road, where we know there's a lot of action. So it's the same overarching objective. We're going to go about it in a very distinct and different way. Does that answer your question?
To put that in the context of the new strategy, we are saving until the strategy itself is finalized, the measures of effectiveness and how to assess the impact that we're having, because we have to get it right. And, you know, I've been in this business 37 years, and getting it right as it comes to M&E is not standard. We sort of missed the boat. OTI gets it right. That's why I love OTI. And we're going to get this new strategy right.
I think also the movement towards theories of change and forcing people to articulate theories of change helps a lot, because you're saying, okay, we're changing our, we tested the strategy, the dynamics. Sometimes it's not even that the strategy is wrong, the dynamics are just different. But you're saying we're going in this direction now, and here's our theory for why we think going in this direction makes sense. So that's providing more common narrative, I think. That's helpful for people to be able to absorb.
It's very helpful for every staff member who's involved in the effort to understand what they're supposed to do on any given day and what each step is.
You just add, you know, the long-term value of doing this, the individual level theory of change and then the evaluation at the activity level can feed into not just the program objectives, but the longer-term planning thinking about what types of activities might work in development systems. So we've already experienced the challenges that future long-term development programs might encounter, and therefore we can offer that advice and guidance through the outcomes of the OTI communities.
Does anyone want to speak to the middle belt violence or the challenge of the governance issues and how to juggle that when you're on a larger political level and knowing what you're dealing with and how to do that, or on a local implementation level?
I can touch on both of them quickly. So the middle belt issues gradually developing over the last few years, and very recently it's gotten very hard. We had to pick our battles, finite resources, finite time. Also, that was an inherently Nigerian issue. It sounds a bit harsh, but that was an inherently Nigerian issue, which for a program whose purpose was to address the threat of violent extremism related to Boko Haram and ISWA, it felt like there was a more indigenous solution to that problem that didn't quite require us at that time. I think it's taking on a very different flavor now, so that might be different in the future. And on the overall governance issue, again, that's a massive problem. And I understand there's a status in the pre-solicitation phase. There are other programs who can deal with these much longer-term interventions of the persistent failure of Nigeria's government and governance. We were willing to take it on to the degree that it was identifiable and exploited as a grievance, which extremist groups were willing to recruit for. But as I mentioned, only 1 year, we saw very little effect by addressing a whole-of-community approach. We again had to pick our battle and say, let's work with the individuals that we know are causing the problems, rather than whole communities, because the Northeast population is about 20 million people.
I would say about Middle Belt, as it relates to the counter-Boko Haram ISIS West Africa phenomenon, it's potentially could force or prod the Nigerian government to pull resources away from the Northeast to the Middle Belt. They have not done that yet. At least not in any appreciable way that we have discerned. But it's a very real risk.
Other questions? Yes.
I'm from Syria. And in Nigeria, there's a large Syrian community. There are words in Syrian community over there. We do not get evaluation for the refugees in Nigeria. And I have some comments or questions. Number one, as you mentioned, Nigeria is one of the richest countries in the world. Still, the GDP is the lowest in the world. The corruption is in the government, not on the governing body. It's in the government itself. And the absence of transparency of the government, the absence of democracy, will empower Boko Haram. So fighting one part without addressing the other part, you will reach to nowhere. This is the whole Middle East, all third world countries, phenomenon. That they bring you the American to fight the terrorists, and in between you get most terrorists for the opposition. The other things, this is my question for you. Nigeria is a very rich country, I think. Adopting a new technology for agriculture, for solar system, for anything, it can help the people to get a lot of money in very short time. I see always USAID or state or US government, they always hesitate to implement new technology that the United States has, not restricted one for public one, to implement it in these rich countries. We have the same problem we have in Jazeera in Syria, now we have in Nigeria, which is a very rich country. $20 million for Nigeria for agriculture, I think it's, you can make a boom.
If you make a what?
You can make booming in the economy if you use it with technology. With technology, I'm not saying agriculture. This is the two points.
I'll take one more question. Yes.
I'm Peter Donald. I've been the regional successful I'm concerned about the long term view. Like, I can't remember what OTI does in the stabilization projects, but several of you presented, like, the situation's going to get much worse, not better. Lake Chad's going to disappear, you're going to have mass migration, space borderless, etc. So we can do short term, you know, reintegration of a few long top loci, evaluate the EU prison program, the teaching prison, and find it. These are all very short-term. Now, they're important, and they can be successful, and your evaluation can say they're successful, but what's the next Boko Haram? And who's watching? What's the next iteration? Right? We can kill all of them today, but the situation on the ground is going to get worse. It's already cynical. So what's our strategy for that? What's our policy? Otherwise, honestly, I feel out of taxes. And, like, am I going to keep paying taxes for the next 50 years to put out fires? So I'm curious, what is OTI of stabilization? What is the larger strategy and policy for the Sahel and Lake Chad Basin?
I'll give my perspective, and of course the other panel members will have and I'll speak to Peter's question, which is a million-dollar question. I took this job in February of 2015, not because I wanted a job or needed a job. I took it because when I walk one block from my office, I look at this black, shiny marble wall with 58,000 names on it. I mentioned every mark in my remarks. That wall is testimony to the folly of policy driven by filling body bags. I'm of the Vietnam era, probably the only person in here who is. Two of us. Okay. We relate to that. Three of us. You're stretching it. And I said, I'll take this goofy job, but only if, in addition to coordinating security assistance, we help our partners address the underlying driver. I said, if you don't agree with that, don't hire me. I don't want the job. And they said, oh, yeah. We want that. Okay. They got it. And we are focused on what we're talking about. And this is not going to be easy to do. Right now, we're in this whack-a-mole thing I talked about. But we don't have to be in the whack-a-mole. And our help, and why I'm at this conference, is because I believe that in addition to promoting defections, we, USG, we, our P3 partners, EU, bank, others, need to help our Lake Chad region partners start to put Humpty Dumpty back together again. Not the old Humpty Dumpty, the one that we're talking about, all the reasons for Boko Haram, which didn't drop out of the sky. It came for the reasons just talking about. We don't want that old Humpty Dumpty. We want a new Humpty Dumpty, an improved Humpty Dumpty, a one that will give people a chance to live a normal life. Is that asking too much? A normal life, raise your kids, educate your kids, give their kids some hope. So that's what I'm in this for. I don't have to do this. I'm doing it because I believe in that scenario. Is that just pie in the sky? No. Because, and this is the point that Shreve and I were talking outside about. Nigeria, and someone else, you just made the point, this is not a poor country. It produces almost 2 million barrels of oil a day. And more importantly, as a farmer myself, is the agricultural potential of the country untapped. It makes me furious to see this, and water potential untapped just under the ground. So all these things with good policies, good leadership, are doable. And then people say, oh, well, they got skyrocketing population growth, and all true. 7.3 live births per woman up in the Northeast.
Well, I was ambassador of Bangladesh. What do you think their population fertility rate was? 7.3 in 1971, the year of independence. What do you think it is today? 2.2 live births per female. That is right at just slightly above replacement. So things can change. Nobody saw that change coming. But we, USG, and the broader international community, we can help affect change.
I have a thought. So I totally agree with you. I think about that stuff all the time. Two thoughts. Number one, a lot of things that my colleagues say, they hear the Afghanistanization of Africa, West Africa, East Africa. It can't be a military-only solution. We hear a decreased role at the table as in the civilian role. We have to continue to be at the table. We are at the table, and we're actually working side by side with the military in our programs, most notably Niger, also Cameroon, and somewhat Nigeria. But I think the number one goal here is that we have to maintain equal partnership with the military. The other thought that I have is that I lived in Colombia in 1997. And in Colombia in 1997, the FARC and the ELN and the EPL, controlled like 60% of the country. You had to literally drive to go to Cali from Bogota. And these days, you can drive there, so you had to fly. The difference that it made was that all of a sudden, security became extremely important. Information security came in hand, but sequenced and targeted. And bringing the resources of the host government into areas, clear whole bill. We don't want to talk about that anymore. That's sort of out of favor. But the real point is, you can't do anything without security. And until you secure these areas, and until you bring in resources right there at the ground level, and then you start to sequence and target that with short and intermediate and long-term programming, nothing's going to change. So we have the opportunity, I think of it as pockets of security. We have the opportunity, we've seen changes. Borno has definitely gotten much better than it was early days. And we're seeing changes in Cameroon. Cameroon a year ago, we were really worried about violent extremism recruitment, and now it's more of a stabilization environment, trying to actually get people to come home. So there are some incremental changes happening, but the long-term trajectory is definitely going to require the securing of the environment, not allowing, if you're talking about the Sahel, someone brought up the Sahel, not allowing Al-Qaeda and JNIM and these groups to continue to make the move from Mali to Burkina Faso and Niger, and having a really concerted 3D effort. And it's the only way, but I'm always tainted by my Colombia experience, so I do think that we're going to see some changes if we can make it.
But I'm really glad you brought up the case of Colombia, because particularly in the context of talking about the SAR, it's really one of the frequently overlooked cases where really that is where you saw most of the principles of the SAR actually being executed on the ground, and then therefore also the benefits that came from that. So it's a great case, hopefully for another forum. Sometime we'll take a look at that particular example, and then and one thing that a lot of people don't know if they're working inside the U.S. government is, for example, on the USAID side, you know, there is a country development cooperation strategy that, depending on the type of context, is either a two-year strategy that's updated regularly, looking at the long term. It's usually a five-year strategy, and so, for example, you know, an OTI program or really any program within that. USAID program is within that broader vision and long-term strategy, and that feeds into also the embassy's vision in terms of how they want to support that country writ large, which is updated every year as well. So that helps. It is a useful forum for making sure that people are looking at the long-term as well as the short-term. And I don't know if anyone had anything to add on the technology piece. I mean, I would just point to the Global Development Lab, which was part of it, was created to support USAID in being forward-leading, and they do many different challenges, for example, to be able to support technologies to bring to those environments. So I think in the last 5 years, you've really seen a robust effort on the part of USAID in supporting technology and using it as a powerful tool, particularly for these spaces that are stabilization spaces. I don't know if anyone has anything
to add. I'd like to comment on that. Because I don't think I would necessarily have agreed with the assumption of the question, because my own experience in Bangladesh is that U.S. government, through USAID and its implementing partners, was on the cutting edge of implementing appropriate technology.
technology for Feed the Future,
yes,
which is a tremendous program. And it has enabled Bangladesh, the most densely populated country in the world, to feed itself.
So I would like to thank our incredible panelists and thank you to the audience as well for your great questions and your attention. Look forward to continuing this conversation in the hallways afterwards and even after today as well. So